Today is Ask PD Wednesday, the day that you can email in those questions. That email is here on the screen right now. You can send those things in, any Bible questions, life questions, and we'll try to answer those things from a biblical perspective. Now, today we're going to answer this question: how do I apply biblical texts in our modern society? Stay tuned. You know, that quite honestly can be a very difficult question, especially facing some of the issues that we do today, specifically on marriage and sexuality. Those are some very, very tough issues to answer today when our society as a whole seems to be very, very much against what we find within Scripture and very vocal about those things. In fact, I've had a number of conversations over the years and read articles of folks that are saying that, you know, that some of those things, those were for a different culture, a different time, and those are no longer applicable to us today. And so how do we take what's in here and apply it to our society today? I think we need to understand a couple of things. First of all is the uniqueness of God. Many people try to paint two different pictures of God. The God of the Old Testament is a God of wrath, and the one of the New Testament is a God of love. And they focus on the New Testament, and the God of love then is approval. His approval is of anything and everything that I desire and makes me feel good. Understand, though, God has not changed from the Old Testament to the New Testament. He remains the same. That's part of who he is as a holy God. He is distinct. He is separate. I'm forgetting the word off the top of my head. There's a theological term for it, but meaning he does not change. And so the requirements that he has in the Old Testament are still the ones he has in the New, as far as his desire for us to emulate who he is. To his character is what we are to strive to emulate and to apply within our own lives. The other thing is this, is the uniqueness of the Bible. You know, this thing, this book is comprised of what we call 66 other books written by 40 different authors over the period of 1,500 years. And all of those men were different levels of education, expertise, situations in life, different time periods and cultures. And yet we find that the message remains the same throughout. It communicates the same thing. There's nothing contradictory in here. And because of 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 16, and 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 20 to 21, talks about the fact that it is indeed inspired by God. In other words, God used the unique personalities of man to compose these things, but God is the one behind it, directing man what to write. He is the ultimate author of this book. And so we shouldn't be surprised then that the things remain the same. So how do we apply it, though? Paul and I approach it from this angle. We approach it from an exegetical study. What does that mean? It means that we look at the context of the passage. We look at it historically. We look at the languages. We look at everything that was happening within that particular time period and how the readers themselves would have understood it. And, you know, we have books, you can see it on the shelves behind me, that I do that with. I have $1,000 software programs to do that with as well. But you can just as easily do that online. Something like Bible.org is a good spot to do that. Or Blue Letter Bible as well offers tools and resources for you to be able to do that. But as we do that, then we're able to grasp what it meant at that particular time to that particular group of individuals and what was being communicated. Understand, though, that through all of those things, there are timeless principles that we glean from this. The book of Leviticus, for instance, you know, that's a lot about the law. Those things aren't particularly applicable to us today, but yet as we read the book, as boring as we might think it is, we find something important there. It reveals to us what the holiness of God's character, his distinctness, how separate he is as well from his creation. And it leaves us with a better picture of who God is in his character. And even as boring as it might be to read that for us, it's still important for us today to understand who he is. What else? We also need to approach it, I guess, with a few questions. As we go to study, many times we find today people going with a particular agenda as they come to study. They have a specific idea, a specific thought, and they're looking for the scriptures to affirm that, to approve that. Rather, we need to come to the scriptures letting it speak to us and asking perhaps these particular questions. What does this passage teach me about God? What does this passage teach about the church? What does it teach me about the world or about myself, about my own desires or motives? What does this passage require? What action does it require that I take? And if so, what action should I take? What do I need to confess or repent of? And what have I learned from this passage that will help me focus on God and strive for His glory? I think probably the most important thing to do is to study again that context. And as we do, to ask these questions. And as we ask those questions, many times those timeless principles will just jump off the page at us and reveal themselves. Remember, God remains the same. His requirements of us remain the same. He still requires that we be holy as He is holy. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 to 16 talks about that. And that we remain distinct. And how do we do that? How do we, as Matthew talks in chapter 22, love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength? It means that what? We walk in obedience. And these words in here teach us what that means, show us what that looks like. And then as we gain the general ideas, if you will, we can come to our own cultural context today and what that means for us, specifically with application. So we get the study. We know what it means. We grab the principle from it. And then as we have the principle, we can make specific application to our own lives today. I think oftentimes, though, the mistake that many make as they approach it again with an agenda, specifically right now on this idea of marriage and sexuality, there's an agenda there. You know, God wants me to be happy. And so as I go to the scriptures, oh, God is a God of love. Well, He loves me the way I am, and He approves of these things, and we find what a very, very different story. Yes, God loves you, but He also desires that you change as well, doesn't He? He desires that we not be in sin, but that we follow Him in obedience and in holiness, morally and in His character, to emulate Him, to imitate Him. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1. Those are a few things. That's a much more exhaustive subject, I understand. But those are a few things, a few tools to add to your toolbox, if you will. Again, Bible.org, Blue Letter Bible. You can look at those couple of websites. If you have other questions or need resources, please come see us here at Grace. Come ask. We'll be happy to provide those things for you. If there's any other questions that we can ask or answer, that's what we're here for. We desire, again, that people be equipped in the Word and through that be able to minister to those around them. Praying for you. I hope those things help out today. Until tomorrow, friends. God bless.